My name is Paige McMurray. I'm 32 years old. I live in Hattiesburg, Mississippi. It's a crazy story. So in 2015, I was diagnosed with a carcinoid tumor of the left upper lobe. I had been having symptoms for, when I think back on it, it's 6 months or so, and I just felt bad. I felt very tired, very fatigued. And I thought that was normal because I'm a nurse and I was working 12-hour shifts and everybody that I worked with was super tired all the time, you know. But it was debilitating fatigue.
Well, most of the time I see neuroendocrine tumors start out somewhere in the abdomen, so primarily in the small intestine or pancreas. But up to about a quarter of the time, they can start out in the lungs. And that's what my primary focus is. So when we look at neuroendocrine tumors of the lung, we break them into essentially four different categories. So going from the slowest to the fastest growing, we label them as typical carcinoid, atypical carcinoid, large cell neuroendocrine carcinoma, and small cell lung cancer. Many times the typical and atypical carcinoid tumors develop over a number of years. Some people can be asymptomatic and these things get picked up incidentally. Sometimes people can have respiratory symptoms. So cough, shortness of breath, wheeze. I see a lot of recurrent infections. Sometimes people get misdiagnosed as having asthma or COPD. And it's not until somebody does the proper scans and workup that this gets diagnosed. These symptoms kind of mimic other types of lung cancers. The exception is some of the hormonal type syndromes that can come along with this. There was one patient that I had that had a very unique presentation.
I Googled all my symptoms and they came back as Cushing syndrome. And I said, I think I have it.
So she had an elevated hormone called ACTH. Many times this is a result of excess cortisol from the adrenal glands, and this can produce these types of symptoms.
I started thinking, what if I'm crazy? Like, what if this is just all in my head, you know, and I'm under so much stress because of my life? What if I have in some way cultivated these symptoms?
In her case, it was found to be produced somewhere else. And so her doctors went looking for this and found a small nodule in the lung.
I said, well, I don't smoke. I don't have any history of, you know, I've never had any lung problems, no asthma, anything like that, you know, so what would cause me to have a nodule in my lung? And so I underwent a wedge resection of my left upper lobe. It was an exploratory kind of surgery. They didn't know that that's for sure what it was. And as soon as he removed it, my levels dropped. Whenever they checked my blood in surgery and my levels had dropped and then sent it off to pathology, and it was a carcinoid tumor.
So many of the fears that the patients have that have neuroendocrine tumor or the unknown. It's a rare disease. Not many people know about it. We get probably half of our population come from out of state, and they come from small towns in a lot of different states throughout the United States. And they're just really afraid because they give us the message that my doctor has never taken care of a patient with neuroendocrine.
There was no mention of that this is a very rare type of tumor. This is a neuroendocrine tumor. I was never referred to a specialist, like a neuroendocrine specialist. That's really what I needed. I want to walk in somewhere where they're like, oh, we do this every day. My husband found the NOLA NETS program in New Orleans.
So it's really a fear that their treating physician at home is not able to provide them the information or the care that they want and they deserve. So we assure them that we work together with their local doctors to help take care of them. We coordinate plans, we communicate on the phone, we communicate electronically, we share clinic notes, and I think that gives them a lot of comfort knowing that, one, we've heard of this disease, and two, that we're here for them, and we're able to help take care of them no matter where they live.
Right now, she's doing great. She's been treated with stereotactic radiation to her recurrence, and we've been following her, and she's doing well.
I've been in neuroendocrine tumors for the last 15 years. Advances that I've seen with lung nets or minimally invasive surgeries, just diagnostic testing, just across the board, diagnostic testing and minimally invasive surgeries and new medications that got FDA approved, it's just really remarkable.
Primary treatment for lung nets at an early stage is surgical resection. That's the gold standard. But there's more and more evidence to suggest that if we can get away with what we call lung sparing surgery, we can do that with some of the lower grade tumors and have a good outcome. So we try not to take the entire lung if we can. In some instances, we have to. So the right side has more capacity than the left side, so we particularly try to not take the entire right lung if possible. But most of the time, we can get away with not taking the entire lung.
If you have a lung neuroendocrine tumor and you need surgery in part or the entire lung is removed, there are certain restrictions potentially that you may have. Everybody's different. So I can't tell you one way or the other that how you're gonna respond, but basically you can have some symptoms. You can have some shortness of breath, you may be on oxygen, you may have some limitations with activities, but again, everybody's different depending on the extent of what needed to happen medically and the reserve that the patient has and how they are preoperatively, how active they are. So all of that goes into play when you're looking at what can happen. But you can live a pretty normal life.
Right now, there's only one FDA-approved therapy for patients with neuroendocrine tumors of the lung, and that's everolimus, or the drug Afinitor. And what this does is this inhibits a certain pathway that these cancers use to grow. Sometimes we can use some targeted radiation, so something called stereotactic body radiotherapy, or SBRT. This seems to be beneficial in patients who are inoperable, so it seems to have just as good a benefit as surgery.
Our center is multidisciplinary. We have a group of physicians and nurses and research and palliative care, pathology, our whole team is involved. My role in this is to really just add the information about patient barriers or concerns that patients may have with certain treatment options being offered.
DIPNECH is an acronym. It stands for diffuse, idiopathic, pulmonary, neuroendocrine cell hyperplasia. So this is an abnormal growth of the neuroendocrine cells that line the pulmonary system. And because of this, what can happen in some cases is patients can become symptomatic with some of the normal respiratory complaints of sometimes what is described as asthma or COPD. So many times patients will come in with a chronic cough or wheeze or shortness of breath. And in many cases, this can go on for a number of years until there's actually a diagnosis made. And the diagnosis is made by doing a biopsy. So in many cases, we can pick up DIPNECH alone, just based on symptoms and some of the characteristic findings on the CT, and then ultimately a biopsy. Sometimes we find this at the time a carcinoid tumor is removed from the lung, so we'll take the carcinoid tumor out, but we'll look at the periphery of the lung and find that it is involved with DIPNECH. Invariably, many patients with this diagnosis have already been treated with various inhalers, cough suppressants, steroids sometimes, and these can sometimes be beneficial, sometimes not. We have found that the somatostatin analogs, so octreotide LAR and lanreotide, can also play a role in treatment of DIPNECH and help suppress some of the symptoms and maybe change some of the biology and improve the pulmonary function testing. Lung nets do have the ability to metastasize, just like any other cancer. Your typical carcinoid tumors will metastasize less than your atypical carcinoid tumors, but this is something that we go looking for when we do surgery. We look for evidence of lymph node metastasis. And these things can really metastasize anywhere. I tend to see them metastasize to other areas in the lung, to the opposite lung. We can see these things metastasize to bone frequently, liver, brain, uncommonly, but it happens. The incidence of the neuroendocrine tumors of the lung is certainly increasing. So I think the more education for thoracic oncologists, neuroendocrine oncologists, general oncologists who are gonna be taking care of these patients the majority of times needs to happen.
What is exciting coming down the pipeline now is the copper scan. So, you know, we're always working on something new. The copper scan is just a different isotope, radioisotope, and you scan the patient in a PET scanner. And it is advantageous for all. It's a very clear picture. It's a shorter, there's no time restrictions with the injections, and it's gonna be more readily available. So we're involved with some clinical trials right now with the copper scan, and we're really excited about that.
The biggest thing in the neuroendocrine world that I'm excited about is the possibility of something called alpha therapy. So this is a radionuclide that early studies show quite a bit of promise for in patients with somatostatin expressing tumors, or somatostatin receptor positive tumors rather. It works really well, low rate of side effects. So I think this is something that we'll be seeing in the coming years.
We're involved with clinical trials. We're involved with the latest and greatest things. We have a big multidisciplinary team that can offer lots of different treatments. So 10 years ago, there wasn't a whole lot of treatments for lung nets or any kind of neuroendocrine patients. There's a lot of things we can do out there. We treat this more like a chronic disease now. Because patients live such a very long time, we have lots of things we can offer, but timing and sequencing of treatment is extremely important. So patients should be very hopeful. What I would advise patients who have neuroendocrine tumors is to live life to its fullest. Try to reduce stress any way you can, and really value every day, and don't skip things because you're afraid to go. We do encourage, we have many patients that may call us and say, I have this cruise planned in 2 weeks. Should I go or should I not go? And we say, absolutely go. We want you to go and enjoy your life. You know, don't miss out on precious things.